I'm Joe Veroni. This is the 4th of April, 1999. This is being recorded at 400 East South J in Gas City, Indiana. I am speaking with William Veroni. Please state your name.
Well, my name, they call me Bill Veroni.
Do I have permission to interview you?
Yes, okay.
Do I have your permission to submit this interview to Marion High School?
Yes.
Do I have your permission to submit this interview to the Marion Public Library?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's begin this interview.
Now, how far back do you want to go? And at 40s, it was still... we were just coming out of the Depression years at that time, you know. Nobody really knew or had much, you know. They lived a very simple life. And you were... The town of Gas City at that time was around 3,000 people, maybe a little over. I don't remember what the population was. But about if you wanted to go anyplace, 90% of the time is your 2 feet carried. You didn't have cars and everything to run around in. And you'd about knew everyone that had a car around in the area, you know. And you would go to visit. You wouldn't go to visit like you do today. If you go to visit, it was 3 or 4 or 5 hours a visit. But today, as somebody comes in for a visit, it's 15 minutes and then they gotta go. Everybody's in a hurry today.
Uh-huh. What did you do for fun?
Oh, we made our own fun. The biggest thing, we played games. Earlier than 40, we used to play Monopoly and croquet, and we'd go fishing and hunting and. Just run around, and nobody had any money to do anything, so we had to make our own fun, what we wanted to do. Play basketball and stuff like that, you know.
If you were to make a living around the late 30s and the early 40s, how would you go about doing that?
Well, I went to work when I was about 13 years old for a plumber. I dug ditches and done all the dirty work for him. His name was Austin Kilgore, and he was a very religious man. I had to watch myself talking to him and all like that, you know. He didn't allow you to do too much talk out of the ordinary. I was paid pretty good for them days. To start out with, I got 30 cents an hour. And then after about 3 months, I raised it to 35 cents an hour. And which was the going rate for, you know, for work then. And I worked for him about 6 months, and then I quit, and then I fooled around for about 3 months, and then I went to work at They called it Slick Glass Company at that time.
Yeah, tell me a little bit about the glass companies.
Well, that was down on the northwest side of Gas City, and at that time they used to make the liners, jar liners and things for canning jars. The inside liner was glass. And I worked on that. I worked on several different projects there, you know, not only that, packing and what they call it, selecting, packing is what you done. And then after that, I went to California. And I had a brother named Art. He went out to California about 3 years before that, and I went out there to stay with him. And he was working at the Owens, Illinois Glass Company out there in Oakland. Mm-hmm. And he got me a job out there. He was working in the batch house where they made the batch for the glass, you know, different colors glass. Uh-huh. And they put me to work. They called me the monkey. I had to go up, and all the high beams in the batch department was all, you know, it was always dusty, and I had to sweep them off and things like that.
Yeah.
Well, I done that, and also shoveled in the big bins the glass that was brought in, you know, for recycling. I shoveled that down, you know, it would hang in the bins there, and you have to shovel it down and unload sand and soda ash out of freight cars. You know, they had what they call an automatic handler. You'd pull that spade back on the cable, and then you shove it down, and it would draw forward and dump it in the hopper. Mm-hmm. And things like that. That was interesting work.
Yeah.
And then, well, let's see, that was in 39. And in the spring of 40, they haul I forget what the name of the place out in the bay there between San Francisco and Oakland. They had the World's Fair just starting. It was starting that year when I come back to Indiana.
I understand that your father was chief of police of Gas City. Could you tell us a little bit about how the law worked, how people regarded the law back then?
Well, the younger generation back in them times, they had curfews. It was 9 o'clock, and you'd better be off of the street. And they respected the law. Let's see. We were forced to respect it.
Yeah.
Because my dad was a pretty stern man, and he believed in white was white and black was black, and there wasn't any in between. Either he was right or wrong. respected the law. We wasn't scared of them. I mean, they were there. We knew what they was there for. And we respected everything, that every decision that they made to protect the rights of other people and yourself. Mm-hmm. And they didn't have a lot of controversy. And at that time, when I was a kid, we had guns, but for hunting. Mm-hmm. That's all we used them for. And we didn't have a lot of controversy about young people handling guns, because we were taught to at a younger age to handle them and respect what they was for. And nobody really had too much of anything back in them days. And in the earlier days of my life, we lived on a small farm east of town, you know that people that had cars, you ran out, and when the car passed, you ran out to see who it was, because you knew everybody that had automobiles. Mm-hmm. And we never did get any bicycles or anything like that to ride. Mm-hmm. We walked every place we went, you know. And it was a kids now wouldn't ever think about putting up with what we had to put up with. Clothes was at a premium, because they had no money and there was no wages, high wages, to buy clothes for their children. My father done the best he could do, mm-hmm. and which he always kept a job. And by the way, in the earlier days, he was a window glass blower, and he would work different places, like in Pennsylvania, Virginia, West Virginia, and Caney, Kansas, and Oklahoma, what they called the fires. It was in the fall of the year, because it was so hot that they couldn't do it in the summertime. Mm-hmm. And he would be gone from home, you know, for 5 to 6 months out of the year while he's working.
Yeah.
And we took care of everything. We had always had 4 or 5 cows there, milk cows, and we had a couple, 2 or 3 hogs and a team of horses, and we had raised chickens. We raised everything that we eat, practically, except the staples like sugar, pepper, salt, and stuff like that. And we had our own, each one had his own work that he had to do out there to maintain herself. My mother was the supreme commander of the bunch while my dad was gone. Uh-huh. And what she said was law to us. And we respected everything and that she needed and wanted, you know. Mm-hmm. We had a good life as far as life went. We never went hungry like a lot of people did during the Depression. I remember people in town that they got laid off of work, and they would sell houses at $600-$700, mm-hmm. just to get away, to get not only something to eat, but try to find another place in the country that they could get a job.
Yeah.
That was before the WPA started in when Franklin Roosevelt became president. And then he started the WPA, and that relieved a lot of the famine and everything here in the country.
Mm-hmm.
And he also incorporated what they call the CCC. It was an organization for youths. They would go out and they down the Mississippi River there, they had camps. And up on the Salamone Reservoir, they had camps. They'd plant pine trees and clean up the river banks and all things like that. And it was more like a military situation, you know. I mean, it was run just like the army was run, and which it taught kids to respect everything and everybody, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the first. I never went because I had work to do out around the farm all the time.
Mm-hmm.
But I know some of them went and took up jobs. They became very, you know, a lot better people than what they were before they went. I mean, a lot of the disturbing factors in life at that time was not nearly as great as it is today. I know that there's a lot of things in that goes on today that didn't go on back then.
Yeah, around the beginning of the 40s, 41, 42, as people were realizing that, you know, war was a possibility, how did people treat that idea of the United States going into another war?
Well, I can remember one of the profound things that Franklin Roosevelt heard it on the radio. He made a statement. He said, "Our boys will never set foot on foreign soil." Let's see, that was... in the late 40s. And then, of course, you know, December 7th, 41, is when Japan
bombed Pearl Harbor.
They started the war, you know, in the Pacific.
Mm-hmm.
And then everybody was wanting to go to the service. I mean, knew that we knew that the war was going to start in Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody was, all the young guys that was turned 18, they was going, trying to go to the Navy or the Marines or the Army, Air Force. And I went down there when I was 17, and I tried to join the Navy. My brother Bob, he joined the Navy. He was 4 years older than I was.
Uh-huh.
And I tried to join the Navy. I couldn't. They wouldn't take me because I was colorblind. And I can see and distinguish every different color there is.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't see the numbers, those round circles. different colored dots. And after they say, tell you what the number was on it, just come out and hit you in your face, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But I couldn't distinguish it, and the Navy required that, you know.
Yeah.
So, I come back, and then I turned 18. As soon as I turned 18, in March, in March 27th, I turned 18. Then I went to almost 19. Well, it was January 1st is when I was called up for the Army. And I went from there, I went to Fort Benjamin Harrison down in Indianapolis. And then I went from there to, I joined the 511th Parachute Troops, the 11th Airborne Division there. And they sent us down to Tocoa, Georgia. That was training down there,
uh-huh.
13 weeks basic training.
Tell us a little bit about that.
Huh?
About your basic training, yeah.
Oh, it was extensive, and it was grueling as heck.
Uh-huh.
I mean, they kept you on the ball all the time. 6 o'clock in the morning, you was up, and Adam, you went out for roll call, and then you was allowed to go back in and do your primary thing. 6:30 was mess, and then you went, you fell out, you went in, you was allowed 30 minutes to clean up your barracks and do whatever you needed to do, and then you had to go out every morning. It was a hill, they called it Currahee Mountain, and it had a roadway around and around to the top of it. It was just like an ant hill, a giant ant hill, you know.
Yeah.
And you'd have to, we all walked up that, or double timed up it, and walked back down every morning. That was one of our calisthenics. And then we, after we got that, they'd have all orientations of different things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
That was part of the service thing, you know. And we went through that for 13 weeks, and then we went to a place called Hoffman Air Force Base in North Carolina, around Rockingham in Hamlet, North Carolina. And we took our basics of jump and jumping, you know, that for 3 weeks, and then we were sent to, it's been so long, down Fort Benning, Georgia. And that's where we took our jump training. And after we took our jump training, they come up with the idea of recruiting guys for a special assignment. And I signed up for it, and it turned out to be the it turned into something else. It was an experimental thing, and it was called the OSS.
Yeah, tell me a little bit about that.
Experimental, and it turned. It was experimental. We went to Camp Swift, Texas, and stayed down there for 5 weeks. And then we left there, and we allowed 15 days delay en route to go to Newport News, Virginia. That was a jumping off place. That's where we boarded the ship. And when we went over, at that time it was the largest convoy of World War II. And it was over 500 ships in that convoy. That's not counting all the Navy and, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, they're just carrying the troops. And it was a, we got lucky. We got to go on one of those Kaiser Liberty ships, and that thing was nothing but a, well, that, it, what would you say, a catastrophe waiting to happen is what they was. It was thrown together just as cheap and as fast as they could put them together when they built them. And we were 28 days going over, and it was right in the stormy season. And you'd be down in the trough of water, looking up, and you could see water around you 50 feet or 60 feet high, and you'd be sitting down in the pit, you know. And then all of a sudden, you'd be up on top of it, looking down, and you see all the ships around you, you know, and everything. It was quite a thing to see. Well, we arrived, we cut off, and it was in the evening, and Spain was neutral during World War II, and the coastline, you know, lit up and everything, and we saw them, and then it was night, we started back down to go into the Mediterranean. You could see the Rock of Gibraltar before it got dark, and they ran into back of submarines, and there was submarine destroyers was throwing them depth charges along, and all, man, I mean, I don't know how many of them that was thrown, but we went on down the coast of Africa until daylight, and then we circled around and come back in through they called it the Straits of Gibraltar, and we went into the Mediterranean, and then we went on into Oran in North Africa. And that was quite a thing.
I'm going to stop the tape and flip it to the other side, so we'll catch up on the other side. Okay, we're going to pick up where we left off at Oran, where we docked. So.
We docked at Oran in North Africa. And they sent us out to a staging area. It was about 3 miles out of Oran, called Canastel. And from there, we Christmas that we had there. And there was, I don't know, approximately 2,000 troops there. And we were waiting for orders to go to what we had to do. And they celebrated Christmas at Canastel. And they had a great big feast, all you could eat of everything for Christmas. And the next morning after Christmas, well, it started early, and real early in the morning, they was, I don't know what it is, they was something wrong with the food, and they was people running up and down looking for a hole to stop at, and they was 17 people, 17 of the men died from ptomaine poisoning, and that was a sad thing to see. It was, I don't know, probably 1,000 went to the hospitals around there to be treated, you know. And then we spent, after Christmas, we spent another 2 weeks there. And then finally they broke us off from there and sent us to what they called City Belbez in Africa. It was out in the edge of the desert. And we went to demolition. All different kinds of demolition, you know. Like British explosive, American explosive, all that was in you know, the what do you call it, the people that was fighting the war. We went through all of that for 6 weeks training, and we handled all different kinds of explosives, you know. Better shut it off.
We're gonna take a break and be back. Okay, we're back and we're gonna proceed with the interview.
After we arrived in Algiers, they were 19 in this bunch that I was with. They had a place out 5 miles out of Algiers, an encampment in the woods with triple rolls of barbed wire around it. They were 19 of us Americans, they were 27 British, and 125 French, and everything as far as the army was concerned, that's when we went into the OSS, we became non-persons. It was the experimental thing that they started. And we supplied the underground in the different countries that was at war with money, arms, ammunition, explosives, and everything like that. We had our own airplanes. They were stationed at the Bleda Airport, about 40 miles out of Algiers. And I would leave. My job was to leave. I was a courier to that, the effect of it. I would have to go from our encampment down to Mediterranean Base Headquarters and pick up the orders that we were supposed to take. And then I left Mediterranean Base Headquarters and I went to our headquarters, which was a villa surrounded by walls and everything, and that's where they were. And give them the orders that I picked up from the headquarters, and then they would give me the orders to go back to fill what we had to do there at our camp. And I done that every day. And we'd do our different things. They had what they call aerial containers, A5 and A8 aerial containers. We would pack in different ways, you know, and take them out and try them out to see the impact resistance and how to pack things, you know, right. Mm-hmm. And we tested them out and everything like that, and then we got it down to where it was operable. And then we had our planes. They were all stripped down. No defense, no gunnery or no nothing in them, except they had wall gas tanks in the back. Because they had to fly from there to Dover, England, and go over enemy territory and drop. There was predetermined drop points that they would drop the stuff that we sent and then go on into England. And they were about 10 minutes time they got there. They were about 10 minutes fuel left to go. Mm-hmm. Okay, it was that far. That was a long distance back in them days. And we supplied a lot of different underground outfits. We knew where. Yeah, well, we knew everything about the war that was going on over there. It was before the invasion. We knew when the invasion was going to start, 3 weeks before they went in, you know. I mean, that we was told about it. And nobody knew about it, I mean, other than our outfit, because we were the ones that had to supply the underground to take care of different things, you know, over there before the invasion of it. And I never thought about it, you know. It was just a job to me. I had to do it every day, and it was my work, and nobody told me what to do, and I done what I was supposed to do and everything every day. And mm-hmm. Going into Mediterranean Base Headquarters, at the time, I thought nothing of it. There was all the generals and everything around there. I had met Charles de Gaulle. He was the French general. George Patton, Eisenhower, and Mountbatten. He was the English general. And I used to see them all the time. That was just part of my job. I had to do, and I never thought anything about it, you know. I spent a lot of time doing things. I went into Italy, which I'll not explain on it, but okay. I was in Italy in Anzio, an invasion of Anzio in Italy. And I'm not going into what we did there or anything else.
Okay.
But it was above Anzio where we dropped in by parachute. And 3 days we worked ourselves back down the beach here at Anzio, and they put us on a LST and took us out to destroyer escort, and we got on that and went back to Africa. And
I'm going to stop the tape. We're going to resume with the interview.
After we'd done our work in Italy, we worked ourselves back down to the beach, and they took us out to a destroyer escort and put us on that, and we went back to Algiers in North Africa. And it wasn't too long after that they had a point system that you spent so much time and you got so many points. And I had 96 out of 100 points. And they sent me back to the United States. I put in an order to transfer to England if I could, so I could go in on the invasion of the old country and France, where it was. And you see, I had my grandfather came over from Jumet, Belgium, and I wanted to be able to go over there and maybe work my way into there and see, you know, where my people come from.
Mm-hmm.
And I had too many points, so I had to come back to the United States. And then they sent us back to Fort Benning, Georgia. Well, when they sent us home, they give us 30 days R&R at home, and then they sent us to Miami Beach, Florida, for 30 days R&R there, and sent us back to Columbus, Georgia. It was Fort Benning, and we taught the officer candidates for about 10 months there, you know, different things, you know, that had to be done. It was before the war was over.
Mm-hmm.
And then they sent me up for discharge. It was September, I think it was, sent me to Atlanta, Georgia to get discharged. And during an interview with one of the officers down there for a discharge, well, he said they had no record of anything, that you being any place or doing anything, which they didn't keep a record of anything. And we were just like, we didn't even exist when we were overseas. And we argued back and forth. I told him, I said, well, I was in North Africa, and I was all up and down the coast in North Africa, and I was in Italy, and they finally wheedled two invasions, one in North Africa and one in Italy, and told him what I'd done and everything, and that didn't make any difference. He didn't believe what I'd done, and I got mad. I called him several pretty good names. Mm-hmm. I got mad, and he was going to throw me in the brig if I didn't stop. And I said, well, you just put down whatever you want on that discharge, because all I want is out. And so that's when I got the discharge. And nobody ever knowed what I had done. But, when I left Africa, North Africa, they turned the OSS from experimental to OSS provisional. And that way they had the ability to have different, get ranks and mm-hmm. everything like that,
Yeah.
But we had nothing. I'll tell you, it's an experience that lives with you. It's an experience that you never be able to ever get unless it happens in war. And I wouldn't take $10 million for the experience, but I wouldn't give 1 cent for any more of it. But I felt like I had done what I was supposed to do as a citizen of the United States.
So how did you feel when you got back and found that there'd be no reward?
They what?
How did you feel when you got back and found out that they had no recollection of what you had done, that you received no reward for your service?
I didn't care. All I wanted, I done what I was told to do, and that is it. I done it, and I don't care whether other people knew about it or anything else. In later years, it turned into the CIA, is what it turned into. So it didn't make any difference. My reward was my life when I got back. And that's all I cared back to, getting back in one piece. Mm-hmm. The rest of it is history. And I don't know whether it was ever recorded or whether I've never checked in on it to find out nothing. And I don't want to know nothing about it, because it's done, it's over with, and that's it.
And so, before the war, people thought a certain way, maybe you know, talked with each other, fears about going into the war and having to fight again, and how is that different after the war? What were people's world views? What did they talk about after the war?
Well, some people carried it home with them. That's all they talked about was, you know, I done this, I done that.
Uh-huh.
And I never did, because it was none of anybody's business except mine what I done, and I didn't care whether anyone knew it or not.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I'd rather they not know it, because when I come back, they told me that what happened, not to talk about anything.
Mm-hmm.
So it was one of them things that you didn't talk about, you know. And I didn't care to talk about it, because it was done. It was never to be relived, and that was the way it was with me.
So you probably were discharged around 1945 or 46.
It was 45. It was after, well, I went in 43, January of 43, 44, 45, September. I was in the service 2 years, 9 months, and 27 days.
So what did you... what did you pursue as a career? How did you make a living starting then? Like, what jobs did you take? And
well, you mean after I come back?
Yeah.
Well, I started out back in, I was working at the Owens Illinois Glass Company.
Mm-hmm.
When I left. And when I come home, I went to work back at the Owens Illinois for about a year, year and a half. And then I got to the place where I was too restless. I didn't want to do the same thing every day, day in, day out. So I started a trucking career, and I was in that 32 years. That's where I made my living, is in the trucking business.
So to kind of wrap this up, overall, when you look at your life before the war and other people's lives then after the war, tell us a little bit about how you think overall that the war changed people.
Oh, it changed. It changed the way people thought. People were closer together than they are now. You know, everything was one for all and all for one. And now it's there's very little bit of conflicts. What do they call it? Political conflicts like Korea and Vietnam and your Desert Storm and everything. And that's here is going on now. Why, it's something that you know, it's got it on. This is the only country that really gives a damn about their people.
Mm-hmm.
And just like ethnic cleansing, Hitler started out that way. And this guy, he should be stopped. And I think all the all of NATO is behind the people that's going to stop him, because that, they can't have that happening. You know, everybody has a right to live, and you can't just walk in and take your life away. That's not right. It's not right for anybody to kill someone else. The only rights that is to kill somebody is during war. And you really, if the thought of war, you really don't have a right to kill each other. And that's a terrible shame that people even consider it now. And all the things that's going on in schools and everything like that, why, it's devastating what people think. One of the things that I think that is wrong is in a family, divorce rates are practically 50-50 today. People stayed together in the younger years, and they looked out for each other. They looked out for their own. The man was the man done the work of taking care of them, seeing that they lived good. And the woman's work was seeing that the children was raised and supervised and everything. Now, the man and the woman works out, and they have no way of really knowing what the children are thinking or what they're doing. They don't have time to sit down and listen to them.
Mm-hmm. So you feel like the war is probably, World War II, the biggest effect would be on the families.
That, you know, it, I don't know, people want too much. They want it, they want it now. They don't want to wait on it. In my family, growing up, my mother worked as hard as anybody would at a job, but she worked to take care of the family.
Mm-hmm.
My father worked at his work to take care of us. And in my family, I worked.
Okay. Well, so we've been taken from the lifestyle and the mentality of the Depression to World War II, and through that, it seems, according to Mr. Veroni, that the biggest effects of the war and war would be the closeness of people and how families functioned. And we've heard, you know, a decade and a half of history. And I just want to thank you personally and for sharing that with us. And that this will be put on file at the Marion Public Library for others to enjoy. So, I just thank you, and I'm going to close this interview, and I think that's all. So.
Well, it's been a pleasure talking to you. I don't know, maybe I blowed my horn sometimes, and I hope I didn't.
I think it was great.
This is life, and it will be life for, I hope, that sometime, somewhere somebody will listen.
Okay.
And it makes a difference to them what goes on in the world, and they will change their ways of living and their thoughts to the betterment of Christ is Almighty.
This concludes the interview, and this is Joe Veroni closing off.